Thank you for joining the Oak Gate Overview and Installation Training. My name is Dave Obert. I will be your trainer for today. I'm also the Oak Gate Products America Sales Development Manager. So if you have any questions about this training, about Oak Gate products, how to use them, how to buy them, my email is here on the screen. Please feel free to jot that down. Send me an email. I'll be happy to get back to you and answer your questions. Oak Gate is part of Teledyne LeCroy. Teledyne LeCroy provides an extensive range of tools for electrical, physical, logical, and protocol layer testing. It doesn't really matter if you're trying to do PCIe, NVMe, CXL, HDMI, Bluetooth. Chances are Teledyne LeCroy has a tool to help you with your test and validation needs. In addition to tools, we also do expert level testing and provide services. Perhaps you just want to outsource that testing. We're happy to do that for you. If you need help in understanding a protocol, we can provide training for you. For example, if you want to understand what CXL is all about, we're happy to provide a class. Or if you want us to help create tests, maybe security is an issue for you, we can certainly go create those tests. So whether it's hardware solutions or services, Teledyne LeCroy is a full service provider for your testing and validation needs. Within Oak Gate, we have three main appliances. We have the desktop appliance, which you see here. We have the expandable desktop appliance, which you see here, and then our 3U rack mount appliance. Now, the two desktop appliances can go in your office. The rack mount appliance is really built to go in a server room and is really not suitable noise-wise to be in a desktop environment. For Gen 5, we will just have the expandable desktop and the rack mount appliance, but we will have a basic and a pro version of both of these tools, with the basic version being a little less expensive, the pro version being more expandable, and we'll talk about that here in a sec. So into both my expandable desktop and my 3U rack appliance, I can put in a 4-bay module, which you see pictured here. These 4-bay modules in Gen 4 come in single port, dual port, or multi-protocol if you want to be able to test SAS, SATA, and NVMe. And they go into this slot in the expandable desktop. And they can also go, you can put two of them into a 3U rack mount appliance, and they go on the left side and the right side here of the 3U rack mount appliance. When we move to Gen 5, these modules will switch from being 4-bay modules to 8-bay modules. Again, they will plug in here and here and here. And the Gen 5 versions, you will not have to, except for U.3, you will not have to choose between single or dual port. They will be auto-switching between single and dual port. Now, to the 3U appliance, I can also add an external enclosure, which we call our 12-bay enclosures. That enclosure will cable externally to the appliance. In Gen 5, the enclosures will actually move from 12 bays to 16 bays, and those enclosures will connect both to the 3U Gen 5 Pro and the expandable desktop Gen 5 Pro. Okay, now let's talk about the Oak Gate hardware peripherals and the connector types that they have. The first type of peripheral are our Oak Gate interposers. These work in our Gen 4 R300 appliances only and provide a CHEM AIC adapter that allows you to plug the interposer into the backplane and your CHEM AIC type card into the top of the interposer and be able to pull power, toggle purse, do all those kinds of things. The 4-bay Gen 4 types of modules come in a U.2/M.2, where M.2 requires an adapter, U.3 or E1.S form factor types. For Gen 5, we will be adding a Chem AIC type of module, an E3 module, and we will be adding an M.2 specific module that you can plug M.2 drives directly in and you won't need an adapter. All the modules provide the ability to swap power, pull pursed, the ability to do MI. All those come as part of the module built in. For our enclosures, in Gen 4, we provide again the U.2/M.2 with an adapter enclosure, a U.3 enclosure, an E1S, and an E1L enclosure. For Gen 5 Pro only, we will have an enclosure type that allows plugging in a Chem or AIC card. It will have a piano hinge top that allows that to be plugged in, an E3 type of connector, an E1.L, and an M.2 specific connector type for the Gen 5 enclosures. One exciting thing about our 8-bay modules is you will be able to swap them in both our expandable desktop and our 3U appliances. So if you are doing U.3 today and want to do E3 tomorrow, you can just pull out the U.3 module and plug in the E3 module and go forward with your E3 testing. This will make the Gen 5 appliances much more flexible than the Gen 4 appliances have been previously. When connecting the enclosures, a couple things to keep in mind. And here we're showing a dual port enclosure, Gen 4 dual port, connected to a 3U appliance. The first thing is when you plug in this plug here, you want to make sure you actually hear an audible click. If you don't hear a click, unplug it, push it in firmly until you actually hear it click. Coming out of this plug are four cables. You want to take the top cable and plug it into the leftmost slot, and then working your way down, you want to work from left to right over here, so the last cable on the bottom plugs into the rightmost slot. You won't use these plugs over here, just these here. If you're using single port, you'll only have one card with one set of cables, and that will plug into the bottom here that you see in this picture. You want to make sure the little tabs are to the right when you plug it into the 3U and facing up when you plug them into the enclosure itself. The enclosure also ships with a USB connector. You want to put in the USB type A connector here into your 3U and the USB type B connector into the enclosure. Please don't forget that. People often don't see it or don't realize it, and then forget to plug it in. Lastly, turn on your 12-bay first before turning on the appliance. That will ensure when the appliance does get turned on, all the devices are recognized and everything comes up correctly. So turn on the 12-bay, let it come all the way up, and then go ahead and power up your 3U appliance. Once you're up, you'll be ready to start with the software installation once you have the hardware up. Now, the way this will work is you will have a client installation and you will have a server such as your 3U that hopefully now is plugged in, cabled up, and ready to go. With that 3U, you'll be connected to a series of DUTs, either an NVMe adding card, a 4-bay module, or a 12-bay module. The server is an optimized traffic generation device whose sole job is to send traffic against the DUT. The human interface is the client software, and it takes the information from the server as the server is performing the test and displays that information back to the user. Because these work together in real time, this link between the client PC and the test appliance cannot be broken. So this connection has to remain. What that means is if I set my test up on my portable device and get my test running and then shut my device down and go to a meeting, or unplug it and go to a meeting, my test is going to stop. Because of that, what many people will do is set up a client PC on the local area network next to the test appliance, install the controller software on that PC, and then remote into that PC and kick off their tests using the remote PC, which will then stay up and manages the appliance. So we recommend doing that. It gives you more flexibility, particularly in today's world where people are often remote. It allows you to remote in from anywhere, define your test, get your test running, and then go about your business. If you're going to do that, a couple things to be aware of in terms of the remote software is the client software is Java-based, where the appliance is Linux-based. On the Java side, you want to make sure that you don't have an issue between Windows and Java that creates a problem. So you want to go to your group policy editor on the PC that you will be remoting into. All right, so this is the local client that you've set up next to the server. Once you've brought up your group policy editor, you want to go to computer configuration. Okay, you'll see computer and user configuration. You want to go to computer configuration, then administrative tools, then Windows components, all the way down to remote desktop services, remote desktop session host, and then highlight remote session environment. Once you've done that, you will see the option to use WDDM graphics display driver for remote desktop connection. This is what you want to highlight. And when this comes up, then you are going to go ahead and make sure that you click on the disabled button here. And then you'll want to hit apply, OK, and restart your system. And that will enable the system to work correctly between Java and Windows Remote Desktop. And with that, you should have no problems going forward in using the Windows Remote Desktop as a means of controlling the client that will interact with the appliance. Okay, once you have installed your software, there's really going to be three main areas that you're going to be using the OakGate software. The first is in product validation. This is really doing functional integrity testing, uncovering really hard to find bugs, complex traffic generation, low level errors. These are the kinds of things that you can really only do if you have a custom driver like the OakGate has. In addition to the exerciser, we have built-in protocol conformance, and these are built-in suites of tests for confirming that your device meets the NVMe spec, or SAS, or SATA. The case of OakGate, we have our own set of conformance tests that we have built. We also have tests that align with the UNH spec. We have tests for the OCP spec. We have tests for the TCG spec. So we have a broad range of positive and negative testing that you can use to be able to verify that your device in fact meets the industry standard protocols that are in the marketplace. Lastly, we have a whole section on performance benchmarking. These allow you to really measure the true performance of your drive. As we said, we tunnel through the kernel space to be able to really understand the true hardware performance. And we can do that both with SNIA tests, which are built in and ship with the product, or you can design your own corner case testing to understand what does my performance look like if I hit my drive with very large trims at the same time that I'm running 4K reads, as an example. So under these three main areas, we have a built-in protocol analyzer. Now, this is not a Teledyne LeCroy analyzer. This protocol analyzer only works at the NVMe level, and it will allow you to understand, I sent this NVMe command and I got this response back. It does not decode the entire packet as a LeCroy protocol analyzer would and give you the PCIe layers and some of those other layers. It's really just at the NVMe level. We provide power and temperature management. All of the Oak Gate modules and enclosures that we talked about earlier have built-in power cycling and power measurement, in addition to the interposer that we shipped. So all those devices will allow you to pull power, toggle purse, measure power. The Gen 5 systems will have some new advanced, even greater power capabilities. And if you want to do temperature testing, we ship a range of ovens that will allow you to be able to test your drive under different corner cases, under different temperature tests. And then lastly, automation. We have a built-in tool, and there will be a whole class on that, where you can look at how to use our built-in tool to create scripts internally. We also have a Python SDK that you can use if you want to set up a Python framework and have that Python framework run your tests in an automated fashion. Maybe you have nightly firmware builds that you want to test. Those kinds of things. Our Python SDK will allow you to do that, and everything that we do in the GUI, we can do in the Python SDK. So those are the components of the software. Let's talk a little bit about the structure of the releases. So Oak Gate has an LTS model, long-term support model, and what we do is we designate every other release as an LTS release. So with 4.6, you'll see 4.6.1.2, we're out to 4.6.9 now. There is a 4.7, it's been replaced by 4.8, and now we're on 4.8.0, 4.8.1. And so when you go to purchase an Oak Gate, it will come pre-installed, but you'll still want to download the client, and you do that by contacting your support rep. Now, generally, you'll probably want to take the latest release and download that, but either release will work. The intent of these LTS releases is to allow you to make a trade-off between stability of the release and new features that are being introduced. Not everybody needs every new feature, and potentially, if they don't need those features, would prefer to have a release that has a longer cycle of bug fixes applied against it. When you go to install the client, what you will be given is access to the Teledyne LeCroy share, as you see here. You'll have, your company will have their own section, and you'll go to the releases section. Once you're in the releases section, you'll see a folder that says archive and a folder that says current. You want to go to the folder that says current. In this folder, you will likely have these four folders. One that says Enduro SDK, and in this case it's 4.6.9, Enduro SDK 4.8.1, and then we have SVF controller 4.6.9 and SVF controller 4.8.1. With that, you'll want to go into the one that says controller. If you're doing a Python installation, you'll use the Enduro SDK. But in our case, we want to just download the basic controller. So you'll go into one of the folders here, and you will see these set of releases. You're going to see a couple different options here. Okay, so you're going to see a couple different options here. You're going to see the DT SDK, and this is if you want to create your own directed tests. Maybe you have some customer-specific or vendor-specific parts to your drive. You want to create a DT to validate those and test those. You can use the DT SDK to write your own directed tests. This is all done in C. But if you have that knowledge and you want to write those tests, Oakgate can serve not only as a platform for testing, but as a platform for you to build your own set of unique DTs that you would run against any DETs that you were testing. We also then have our two installation types. One is install 7z. This is what you would install for Windows. And then the install tar for Linux, if you want to use Linux. In this case, once you've decided which one you want to do, you're just going to click on it. You're going to come in here and say, okay, I want to download this. And it will start the download process and start downloading the software for you to be able to use. Once that download is complete, you're going to have a zip file that you will need to unzip. And once I've unzipped it, this is what it will look like. And it will give you these set of files with an install.bat file down here at the bottom. So what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and install this one, just to give you an idea of how that looks. Okay, once you click on it, this will come up. It'll say, welcome to Enduro, select installation type. If you are using a Daichu oven, you'll have this installation type. If you're using an Oakgate appliance, then this is what you'll use for the installation type. We're going to click on appliance, and we're going to click on current user install. It will come up and ask for a directory. Now, this is not going to install over previous versions. It will leave previous versions there. In case you want to roll forward or roll back, you may need to use different versions if you're working with different customers. Maybe they're on a different version. So you can roll the version that you're using forward and back. So it will not overwrite. It will create a new directory. I'm going to hit next. We're going to accept. And it's going to go ahead and do the installation. It's going to say installation successful, and we'll say finish. Okay, once the installation is done, you will have the little Enduro icon, and you can see here I have the 469 and the 481 icon. Once that is done, we want to go ahead and launch it. When we do, these two windows will come up. One key thing you want to do is make sure you hit allow access here. The client software will look for appliances that you have on the network. And so if you don't allow access, the Windows firewall will block that from going out and searching for that. In some cases, you may already have something. You would go ahead and import configuration. I'm going to assume you haven't used this before, and I'm going to say don't import. And when you hit don't import, this is going to pop up. You want to go ahead and type your name in here. And the reason you want to type your name in is when I go ahead and use the software, people are going to want to know, okay, who's using a certain device. If your name is there, they'll be able to do that. If all you have is have left the IP address, then somebody else will have no idea who you are if you're in fact you've locked up the device and you're using the device. So I'm going to hit OK. Once I've hit OK, then this brings up your application. And so in our case, then you can go ahead and search for appliances. As an example, I am going to pull up I'm going to search for appliances on both of these subnets, and I'll do a search, scan, and it brings up, it found the device on 10.10.4. So when I look at that device, I can go in now and see what's going on with this device. If I go to click on to use this device, notice how everything is grayed out. The reason I can't use it is this device is 470 and I'm using client 469. So I will want to go ahead and update the software. And you'll see the software is updating. And once the software is finished updating, and you'll be ready to start using the appliance and start the three steps in terms of the discovered systems configuration and defining traffic, which is the whole essence of our next training class. So here it's updated. And again, I can roll this forward, I can roll this back and set it at any level I want. And once it's set, then I can go ahead and get started. So that ends this training on the overview and installation. Again, if you have any questions, feel free to email me. Otherwise, thank you very much for your time, and I hope you look at and enjoy the next training, which is on basic use of starting, configuring, and using your appliance. Thank you. Have a nice day.